you, the chairman, for the kind introduction. And thank you for inviting me to join this conference here in beautiful Minneapolis. Good morning, everybody. So I have to admit, this is the first time I ever present not on bone results, on analytical methods or findings of MCPD. So it's neat to talk on risk assessment and regulation. So I might not fulfill your high expectations in this case. So my talk is on the recent status of EU regulation on MCPD with global all specific performance and analytical solutions available. So very shortly, we can see here the three analyzed as described before. We see they are interchangeable, which likes. And that is challenging, and it's also maybe important in regards to processing consumer. But this is chemistry and not our topic today to make the picture easier. This is the three analytes, and in regard to oils and fats, we more commonly talk about fatty acid bound analytes. Here you see fatty acids linked to the core components. Again, an easier picture, which should indicate that we have monoesters for glycidol only, but mono and diesters for the MCPD isomers. All naturally occurring fatty acids might be linked to the core components. That's why we have a complex mixture of contaminants. Now, as already mentioned, there's some toxic hazards related to the chlorine or the epoxide linked to the molecular backbone. And so the glycidol is a genotoxic carcinogen. No TDI applies but the Aurora principle, and risk assessment is based on margin of exposure. The comparison of the MCPD, non-genotoxic carcinogen, so a TDI applies. And there are no classification available in regard to 2-MCPD. You might ask, what about the fatty acid bound analytes? They have a different molecular structure. Is the toxic impact the same? And, well, ESSA states that animal studies have shown extensive release during digestion. So it is stated that S3-5 and 3 forms were assumed to contribute equally to internal exposure. I have to add on molar base. Recurrence. Why do we talk about oils, fats, and infant formula today? Well, the most important source for formation of bound MCPD is the refining process, especially deodorization. So every refined oil contains these. Analyte is just dependent upon the oil quality, the oil type, and the processing conditions. Just to mention it, bound glycidol is easier to mitigate in comparison to the bound MCPD. If you now use the refined oils to produce infant formula, those products are found to also contain 2-MCPD esters and glycidol. So now, starting with the main topic today, risk assessment. Well, what we have is some long-term toxicological data of rats. Those studies gave a hard value of the T25, which is the lowest compound uptake level at which, within their lifetime, the animals showed to have cancer by contrast with the control group to a level of 25%. So for practical reasons, we divide this by 2.5 to get the T10 value. This means 10% of the animals would have cancer. And then the collating concentration, which has caused this effect, is 4 milligrams per kilogram body weight per day. So this is somehow hard data. Now what do we do with this hard data? Well, the Federal Institute for Risk Assessment, as well as ESSA, saying the margin of exposure should be equal or bigger than 10,000 to have a low health concern. What is margin of exposure? It's a combination of tox data, like the T10 value, with human exposure in order to derive prioritization of genotoxic compounds. It does not start for quantifying toxicity. It just helps to give a ranking. If you have a genotoxic compound and a high exposure, there's a high need to minimize this exposure. If you have the same genotoxic compound with a low exposure, it's not as important. That's what the MOE is for. And now, to have the low health concern, the human exposure should be 10,000 fold lower than the
2070, we might lose 460 microgram per million body weight a day via 10,000, and this is the maximum intake you should have to be still in the level of low health concern. And this genotoxic compound is a little bit the same as the sports. This means low health concern does not mean no health concern. We have to remember this. So now, how to use the margin of exposure? And I try to give an example to derive my individual margin of exposure by a few assumptions. So if I estimate a vegetable fat intake of 25 grams per day, just an assumption, and in the first case, it will contain 2 milligrams of glycidol in average. In the second case, just 1 milligram per kilogram of glycidol. Then we calculate the gram per kilogram or microgram per kilogram body weight per day, and do the calculation very simply, again, D10 divided by my exposure, and then the corresponding margin of exposure in the first case would be below 10,000, and I would have an elevated metabolic risk. In the second case, I'm above 10,000, there's a low health concern. But I'm not representative to all consumers, of course. And so, what has been done in the past? Well, in practice, of course, risk depends on food consumption. And the people are different and they consume differently. So, you can see this very nicely by these pictures. It is a difference. These persons have different risks in regard to MCPD and glycidol. How can we estimate the MCPD by this maximum glycidol contents in ours? And it started with an assumption made, or an assessment made by the BFR early 2000s. So they use the vegetable fat consumption data from a Robert Koch Institute nutrition survey. You see, men and women consume very differently. And we have 75 percentile or max value. We know the hard data again, this max visible intake to be on the safe side. And combination of those data would allow us to estimate average visible max contents of fat. Of course, the question is, do we want to have safety for all consumers, even those ones with an absolutely max content of fat intake? I mean, they live as unhealthy that the MCPD glycidol is maybe not so important. And furthermore, we see that this approach has some limitations. First of all, this data is not reliable. I mean, P75 value of 8 grams per day, it's not realistic. It would mean that those women, that 75% of the women consume less than 8 grams fat at a vegetable fat per day. This is nonsense. So this was the potato chips we got on lunch for Monday. This one package contains 16 grams of edible oil. So I got into the original data. It is a calculation error. It must be 18 grams at that level. And it consists considered only margarine and oils consumed as such, not the vegetable oils in part of compound foods, puff pastry, instant dishes, and so on. So this does not work. In practice, more recently, 2016, risk assessment was carried out much more comprehensively by EFSA, considering several nutrition surveys and also current state on compound foods. But we have also infants. And here the situation is better because we have data on the max fat intake, which is significantly higher than 1,000 grams. And as those infants which are not breastfeeded have this infant nutrition as only nutrition source, there's no question, no deviation. So these values we calculate here are reliable. And we see for powdered infant formula, we can very easily calculate to be jealous, a level of low health concern. The maximum content of glycidol should be 17 ppb. So, And now we got this regulation. It came into force in February. Don't be shocked if you have products on the market exceeding those levels. They may remain on the market until September. And you see, the foods covered is vegetable oils that, for the final consumer or for users in eating the food, is the next level of 1 milligram per kilogram. Half of that for those oils that for the production of baby food and processed cereal-based foods and engines. And of course, also next levels for infant formula, for the formula, and foods for special medical purposes, as powder and as liquid. So, to my opinion, this 1 milligram per kilogram intends to prevent having products on the market with levels that might cause elevated health concerns. But now, remembering the max visible content in infant formula should theoretically be 70 ppb. But we see, so far it's 75 ppb for powdered infant formula. This is significantly above what we say is a level of low health concern. So we can conclude the maximum levels seem to be a compromise between risk assessment and technical feasibility of physical mitigation, and maybe also capability of analytical methods. So also we can conclude that in future we expect lower max levels of residual beyond 2019. 3-MCPD is a different thing. We have a TBI, it can be derived by mathematical calculation. Unluckily, we learned that different organizations use different mathematical approaches and we get different TBIs, ranging between 0.8 and 4 micrograms per kilogram body weight per day. And the lowest one was used for trial tabulation in the EU in 2016. So now the question is, what will be the future TDI in the European Union defers to? I have to ask my crystal ball because it's just a kind of prediction. My crystal ball says, in the EU, the authorities will not call on the TDI as high prevalence, so I expect the 2 micrograms per kilogram body weight per day to be basis of a future possible regulation. Risk assessment. If you apply the same approach as before, excluding the adults, we are just more or less complicated. We can now calculate the max 3-MCPD contents in oils and fat used for infant formula or for infant formula itself, and we see in cases with 3 TBIs. So this is very simple. And this is now the draft that has been circulated 2016. Important notice, it says we have to care for the total PMCD content, meaning the free analyte together with the bound. It does not matter if you import it separately and sum it up, or if you have it included totally in your analysis. But you also see the next level for oils and fat at that time, referring to the low TBI, with the yellow column, is 2,000 micrograms per kilogram. If for infant formula, again, the max levels are above what we have calculated to be acceptable. So again, there's a compromise between risk assessment and technical feasibility. Even if we assume that the new TDI will be 2, we see that this 125 ppb of 3-MCPD in power infant formula, we are above the calculated 83 ppb. Conclusions on that. So, if the EFSA follows the EU Commission policy at that date, I expect the TPE to be 2 micrograms per kilogram body weight a day. The quantum panel EFSA states that this established TBI is not exceeded in the adult population, so there is no elevated risk from perspective of the quantum panel. But the situation changes if you focus on the younger age groups. High consumers means high consumption of refined vegetable fats, and it's particularly for infants receiving formula only everyone is interested to know, do we expect the future regulation of the MCPD, how it will be turned out? And again, we have to ask the crystal ball, because nobody knows. Maybe the expert at the EU, but they won't tell me. So I expect that in the EU, we are going to still protect vulnerable infants. I'm convinced there will be a regulation of PMCBD in infant formula. And I suppose as well that the European Commission will cover maximum contents in all infants. Now, coming to the last part of my presentation, do we have analytical methods that serve in regard to regulation? And to evaluate it, I've displayed the demands for vegetables and fats, and we have clear values for visible and draft values for PMCPD, which might increase in the future. The question is, do we have methods available that cover matrices and scope? And yes, the AOCS methods do. Maybe in regard to the total PMCPD, the A method has to be modified to include the PMCPD. But we see limits of quantification are more than sufficient to match regulation. And of course, they are validated as well. And this means it is good news. We have methods available. These AOCS methods also, in the market, have become ISO standards. But the situation is different in regard to analysis of infant formulae. We see a lot of publications have been released, but none of these methods has been developed or validated in purpose to measure EU regulation. And we have to make a new evaluation, same structure as before. Do we have methods which have those matrices in the scope? Liquid and powder infant formula. Yes, there are two very recent approaches. One from SGS and one from SLA. The limits of quantification seem to be more than sufficient. They differ a bit. They have a different approach for determination of the limit of quantification. It's also this the less individual method using triple pot MS, whereas the SGS method uses the same pot MS. What we see is the bad news. They're all validated. Those methods and we propose to become AOCS in the first edition, but that's nice. But so far, they are not validated. And I expect not validation to succeed until September. And in September, the regulation of visible and infant only is completely, totally enforced. But even the authorities have no validated method available to determine the contents. It's a strange situation, isn't it? So, time is over. Some take-home messages. This assessment of glycidol is based on margin of exposure. This assessment of MGD is based on TBI. This genotoxic compounds, there's no health concern. In the future, we want to have, in the end, no glycidol detectable anymore. A regulation of glycidol esters is enforced in the EU, and I expect future maximum levels, especially for infant formulae, will become much more strict. Draft regulation has been circulated, but not set into force as difficult to be isolated right. Regulation also considered technical feasibility of mitigation and analysis. Important to notice. Regarding the last case, a possible future regulation of PMCPD in infant formula might not be predictable by calculating a CTBI factor. This is important to know. You should not take the draft value and say, okay, the new TDI is 2.5 fold higher, so expect the max levels also to become 2.5 fold higher than in the draft. I do not believe that this is the case. Honestly saying, dealing with risk assessment and regulation, I felt like my youngest son on this picture. It's not a comfortable situation. However, I hope I was able to give you an idea how I understand what happens in the EU. And so in this regard, thank you very much for your kind attention.